Good morning, everybody.
Hey, good gang. Morning, good morning, Brent. How are things in San Diego?
Ah, sunny San Diego. Yes, ATD International Conference and Expo.
Ice, baby.
Somebody had to say it.
Yeah, let's get that one out of the way now. We're done. No more jokes. No more puns. It's finished. We've had enough. It's time to stop.
Oh, man. Yeah, it's been great here, though. So weather's been beautiful. The expo is huge. I guess 11,000 plus people here.
Holy cow.
Yeah. So, you know, the numbers vary. You know, ask somebody and they'll say it was 15,000. Ask somebody else, they say it was about 10. So I try to split the difference.
57,000.
Yeah.
It was the biggest ever.
Huge.
More people showed up.
Ever. Yeah, it's the biggest show. But, you know, Barack Obama is a bit of a draw. So it does make a difference.
Yep.
When you can afford the star power, it's huge. But
Yeah.
I've got the biggest question of the day, though, is so everybody sat in Barack Obama's speech and were apparently very moved. I wasn't able to see it myself, but from all accounts, everybody enjoyed it, said he was a great speaker, said that he really moved people. And was, you know, emotionally and everything about the conversation, because it really was a conversation between he and the president of ATD, Tony Bingham. Yes, thank you, Kara. but how is everybody going to remember everything that he said? And as I was contemplating that the morning when everybody else was in there and I was in the expo getting ready, I was just wondering to myself, this might be an interesting way for us to talk about how is it that we get people to remember stuff? And then I remembered the forgetting curve. And then I remembered, well, what about, do people talk about this afterwards? You know, for days and months to come, and is that how they maybe remember some of his key points? How do we do this?
I don't know if you noticed, but I was making my facetious, hey, that's a great segue, Brent, but pace.
That was good. Yeah, I'm trying to make my segues better and better. I'd like to take this one to the chat room and say, how was my segue today, everyone?
Give us feedback. We'd like to know. But you can only reply with smiles or frowny faces, not actual words. Tweets are really only Likert scales.
Exactly.
That is very cool. And I was just, you mentioned Kara, who got a collection of folks with us this morning. That's pretty cool. And welcome to everybody. And if you haven't joined us before, you know what? We're kind of conversational about this, so don't be shy at talking. Thoughts, reflections, or making fun of us, I guess, if you have to, in the chat forum. We keep an eyeball on that or two and like to incorporate that one in, wherever we can. And Brent, you were using, Kara has picked up on the fact that you were using the phrasing, remembering, et cetera. And she's saying, how are they going to?
That's the next level we need to go to, right?
that Kara, she's nothing but trouble. Anyway,
you're making us think too hard so early in the morning, Kara. I don't know if this is acceptable.
We need more coffee.
Now, point. I have a fresh cup.
Ah, Brent, he just took off. He's gone in the middle of the broadcast. But don't worry. Thematically related because he was getting coffee.
I didn't have to go far.
Yes, you were making faces earlier about the hotel coffee, but we'll let that rest.
At least it's hot.
Resting coffee face, I think they call it. There you go. Yeah.
So spaced repetition, let's talk about it.
For sure. Let's maybe throw this out there. What do you want to throw some thoughts in about spaced repetition? I don't know. Do you know what it is? Do you have a sense of it? Could you actually just carry this whole conversation, and Brent and I will make you the presenter, and we'll just have our coffee. That sounds like a good plan.
I like that.
So throw some thoughts. If you've got thoughts at this time of the day already, feel free to throw some in there.
Or maybe the concept is brand new to you, and it's not something that you've even, you know, considered before.
I guess I'm getting a message offline that I'm actually having video issues today, and that's kind of annoying. So if people are watching the video and they can't see me, I apologize for that. I guess we'll have to solve that at some point in time. And I'm not on Wi-Fi, he said to the person who was asking via the alternate messaging channels. Kara says, forgetting is a good thing, really. Yeah, I wish I could forget more, in fact. but then she follows that up with the statement, it helps with the learning process. That seems kind of odd. Forgetting helping with the learning process. How can that be? What's up with that? No kidding.
Yeah.
When we were chatting about setting this up as today's idea, et cetera, I incorporated some stuff around space learning, et cetera, into a couple of presentations that I've done in the past. And that's kind of what we're going to focus on, is that stuff here today. But maybe since the chat is quieted down, maybe Brent, you want to just offer your thumbnail version?
Yeah. So while you're pulling up those slides or whatever, yes, the thumbnail version. It all started with, and Kara can help me with this, as I forget the names and all of the official academic stuff, because I just remember I'm just getting old and I'm losing all of the details. So there's the forgetting curve. Ebbinghaus, that's the name I couldn't remember. I remembered forgetting curve, but I could not remember Ebbinghaus. And the basic idea is that the longer you wait to retrieve or use the knowledge that you gain, the more likely you are to not be able to retrieve it or remember it and take care of it. So there is the way that you fight the forgetting curve is to, over time and stretched out. So there is some science, apparently, to exactly how big of a stretch there should be before recall segments. But I'm good with just saying, force yourself to recall things as often as you can after you learn them or use them, apply them in some fashion immediately, or else you're apt to forget them. The more, you know, I think the apt phrase is use it or lose it. It applies to many different things, but I think it applies significantly in this case, where if you're not constantly forcing yourself to recall, and that doesn't mean just regurgitating information. So I'm assuming, I mean, I guess there's some subtleties here, right? If you, let's say, for example, there were a bunch of bullet points that Barack Obama hit on in his keynote speech, and he, and then you were to look at a slide with those bullet points on it over time, every other day, and then maybe once a week, and then maybe once every other week, would that be the same as forcing your mind, forcing yourself to remember those bullet points? So not looking at it, but actually trying to retrieve that knowledge, those bullet points, that list yourself. And I would argue that it's a much more powerful learning experience to force yourself to retrieve it and then check yourself against that slide. But again, other researchers, other academic folks will probably be able to be much more clear about it than myself. But yes, Will Tallheimer's website. I love it.
Well, and that's Dr. Will Tallheimer, back in 2006 already, has a great paper that looks at the research, not just the theoretical, not just the abstract, I think about, but, you know, what does the research show?
Yeah.
And so a lot of what I've spoken about is very much, you know, based around the information that I got from that. So I thought we'd start maybe here. If you're interested in this in a bit more depth and detail, come to www.worklearning.com And on the catalog page, you can find, and you'll be able to download this PDF, which, you know, is freely available off of his website. And really, not super long, but really helpful. It really frames it, not just talking about what it is, but also frames it in a lot of ways that, you know, that we can apply. I guess that's the word I'm looking for, practical ways for us.
Yep.
In the actual space. So beyond just our today's conversation, if you want to elaborate more, this is a great place as your next step for sure. So,
and you know what?
So that's,
Dr. Tallheimer is a fantastic guy, super nice. I'll reach out to him and see if we can get him to join us and drink a cup of coffee with us in a few weeks so that we can have a spaced repetition episode of the spaced repetition episode so that we all remember this.
That would actually be brilliant. I've had a casual conversation once at the trade show. I was working in the Domino booth. He walked by, I introduced myself and said, said thanks, that sort of a thing. But that's all we had was that sort of brief moment. But that would be actually very cool to elaborate more on this for sure. Yeah. So I've also, because, you know, I had them from a couple of other presentations, I've got some slides here that kind of help us summarize a little bit what he presents in that PDF that you can download. So we'll walk through some of those core ideas because there's some really interesting stuff. It seems a lot of this seems kind of like, well, duh, no kidding, like forgetting curve. You learn something, but if you don't use it, you don't keep it. But there's some subtleties, some interesting subtleties that can play out from us. From an instructional design perspective, so there's the that link again, it's in the chat.
Yeah,
it's been dropped in the chat, and we'll also have it obviously in the YouTube description area too if you're looking for that PDF. But definitely worthwhile just spending time at some of the other things that that Dr. Tallheimer offers in that catalog of things too. Lots of other really helpful tools there for us to leverage in our space. So, you know, a bit of a summary then of, what he walks us through. And he takes the spacing effect and compares it to what's called masked learning, where masked learning is you jamming your head full of stuff, cramming for that exam the night before so you can go in and regurgitate that. But we all know that we took courses in school, lots of classes, and we don't remember much of anything, if anything, from some of those, because really the way that we learned and then studied in order to get that mark on that exam to get us through the course, that kind of approach to learning something, that short-term memorization doesn't really help us learn things long-term. So the mass repetition is that idea of cramming for an exam or doing something, repeating it very closely in succession. And yeah, you have good short-term memory results, but things will just fade. Whereas spaced repetition isn't just repeating, it is the spacing is the thing. It's repeating the learning over a period of time. So doing it, but then relearning it again and again and again until you've achieved a way of putting it into long-term memory. So. Some thoughts then, what is the spacing? What do we need to do? What's happening? Kara had mentioned earlier, forgetting is a really good thing, really. It helps with the learning process. And that's what spaced repetition actually does, is it actually, we start to forget things and we actually have to work to remember them. And it's that working to remember them that actually creates multiple retrieval routes, as they're described, in our memory. So we have more pathways to get to that knowledge, and helps move it then from short-term memory into long-term memory. So the forgetting is actually, and then trying to relearn it again, actually, it's more than just verbatim. It's more than just a photocopy. It's actually enhancing in that way. So.
Yeah, it's funny. This just made me think about something. Todd Enorum, colleague of ours in the learning industry, mentioned yesterday that she has a photographic memory. And I started thinking to myself, how does that work with, like, does she need to repeat things? Does she need to use spaced repetition? Or, you know, anybody, I guess a lot of people have that ability to do that. And, you know, so I wonder how their brains work. If like, do things in short-term memory just automatically zoom into long-term memory? And that's sort of the picture. I mean, it'd be interesting to find out what the correlation is.
It seems almost like maybe the folks with, I never really thought too much other than the phrasing of a photographic memory, but it almost seems like they simply don't have the forgetting curve.
Yeah.
In a sense.
Right. Yeah.
It's like that's turned off maybe, or that they don't have that, or that just doesn't happen, I guess, in a sense.
Yeah.
That'd be cool to dig into a bit.
Yeah, that just dawned on me. And yeah, Ed asks a great question. Would quizzes be good for this? And absolutely. I mean, that's...
There's lots of strategies, lots of things that we can do to help this, to take advantage of this. There's lots of different things that we can do, whether that's us as, you know, from an e-learning perspective or even instructional led or multimodal or whatever. There's all kinds of things that can help take advantage of this. Yeah. And Ed, your question is absolutely, you know, very well timed because, you know, the things that we can do, you could, you know, repeat the same lesson every time. So maybe there's a YouTube video and people go back to it multiple times over a period of time. So maybe with the, with President Obama's speech at or session at ATD, you go back and you watch the video a few more times and keep remembering more and more and more and more of that then will stick, or something slightly modified, a variation of it. Or then even moving the information into a different context, like leveraging stories or examples over time. So you might give people the, you know, here's the task, what you're supposed to do at this given moment in your role. And then later on, sharing stories from other people who actually, you know, a real world case where customer X came to me and this is what we did. And the customer, you know, we managed to solve the problem or whatever. You're not necessarily even teaching the thing over again. You're recontextualizing it, and that helps people with this process. Or things like assessments or activities or actually formal retrieval practice, you know, later on as well. And even just moving it into dialogues, you know, and discussions or other social contexts where, you know, people can talk about this, you know, later on. All of these are valid things that help, you know, so it's not just literally, oh, every 3 weeks you're going to watch the video until, you know, it's imprinted on you. It's about being creative. It's about, and you know, one of the things is that this, if you think about Bloom's taxonomy, you know, we're kind of moving from, you know, from the exact repetition, which is maybe just simply, you know, rote memorization, fact recall, all the way through to activities that can help, you know, with elaboration and application further up that Bloom's pyramid, for example. They could all play a role in all of this. So,
and I think that's an important piece to note, because I like to think of that as, that's our job, right? A lot of our job is to help people with the spaced repetition. And by help, I mean, you know, it's a lot of people aren't going to dig into, you know, the research and the academics in order to get better at their job or whatever. It's our responsibility to offer up the ideas of, and not just the ideas of spaced repetition, but the technologies. And we should be at a certain point utilizing the technology like mobile devices, right? Or if you have a large population of mobile employees that you're trying to train, and you know that a huge percentage of them have Apple Watches or at least some sort of wearable that they get notifications on or whatever, you could send out short little quizzes to as maybe like a text message or just a small short email, and just to force people to think, to retrieve certain elements that are important to them.
Or even, you know, simply sharing an example story via email.
There you go.
You know, we don't have to be super elaborate in some ways. You know, there are lots of simpler fairly straight up, like ways to share this, to you know, help people take advantage of or to trigger the repetition.
Yeah, and that, honestly, that's why I love live streaming collaborative video. I've been a big fan of it since the technology first hit the internet because of that last bullet point, right? Having dialogue, having discussions, this type of technology like we're using right now gives us that ability to very, very quickly connect and meet with our peers and colleagues and have these conversations to be able to actively force ourselves to retrieve this knowledge in order to remember it. Like I always forget Ebbinghaus. I don't know why, but I always remember forgetting curve. So, you know, maybe at some point, if I talk about this enough, I'll remember it as the Ebbinghaus forgetting curve.
And when we start thinking about these, you know, all these opportunities, if we're able to, I think it becomes really important to start thinking about them, obviously, I guess, at the instructional design, you know, level, the planning level. It's not simply, oh, we've made an e-learning course. Oh, now let's throw some things out. You know, if you're thinking about the stories and things later on, well, maybe that shapes how you're, probably should be shaping how you're doing the initial presentation of information, you know, thinking of it as a cohesive structure extending beyond the, you know, the half hour e-learning course, for instance, or the 1 hour ILT session that you were doing or what have you. So
yeah, my motto for our industry has always been training is a process. I mean, training is an event, learning is a process. Technology supports them both, but performance improvement is our ultimate goal. And those four quick bullet points have been something that I try as often as I can to repeat to folks. And it was funny, I actually saw it on, somebody's actually using it as their marketing campaign on their booth at the event, which I thought was funny. I walked by and did a double take and I was like, hey, I recognize that.
So you had a spaced learning model based on that. So here's something too that Dr. Talheimer looks at in his, and it's something that I'd actually like to find out because his document I think it's 2009 is the most recent sort of edition of it that's up there. It'd be interesting to know if there's been more research since then around the intervals themselves. But I mean, what he basically summarizes is that all the repetition is beneficial. Longer tends to be better, and that's because you probably have people, you know, more apt to have been starting to forget. And that kind of jives with the mass spacing, right? The cramming. Well, shorter intervals, well, that's just like cramming. That's not really doing something. But, you know, what it's almost impossible really, though, to precisely say what the ideal interval is. And I think in some ways that's kind of like reminding us that it's more important to do this than to get bogged down in perfection paralysis around it, I think, is the way I kind of interpret this this information. But what's also important to think about is that it's not the only thing that can happen. It doesn't have to be the only thing. You can do other learning because learning other things doesn't interfere with the spaced repetition process of, you know, something else that you learn. So it's not that you have to sort of quarantine people during the spaced repetition process from other learning things doesn't create any issues. So that's important to know. Some things that, how can we do this? And we've talked a little bit about, you know, from verbatim through to different things, but we could be doing, self-contained lessons or repeating YouTube videos that could be doing that. Or maybe we can be doing, you know, prompting people in the real world, with repeated information, or actual practice opportunities, sending people either case studies that they can look at and evaluate or respond to, giving them problems to solve, et cetera. And if you're, a formal learner action plan that you're going to be, you know, doing these things over time and agreeing on it, and that makes it, kind of gives it maybe another level of priority level in a sense, and even just sharing opportunities, people telling each other about it, how something worked for them, examples of when to use it, et cetera, that we kind of mentioned. I mean, there's a whole range of things here, ranging, you know, from fairly simple, you know, in some ways it's not so hard maybe to get people to repeat the same thing over time. More involved would be, you know, a learner action plan where, you know, you've got a more formal strategy. It also, I think, sort of suggests to us too, I think that it's important for us to measure what are the things that we actually need people to remember versus the things that we can provide other tools for them to simply, review, like job aids, when they actually go to do something. We don't need everybody to have everything, but maybe those places where, you know, things are at risk or things are, if you've just been sent some data and you need to put it into a system, well, you've got time in that to consult the job aid, do the steps, and eventually after doing that 5 or 7 times, it gets, you know, easier and you kind of remember it or whatever. But if you're actually talking to a person who's a customer who's, you know, had a bad experience or something, well, you need to know all of your options, you know, in that moment. You don't have time to say, sorry, sir, I have to look at the job aid to find out how I'm supposed to react to you at the moment. So, you know, do we need to do this for everything? You know, probably not. But there are obviously going to be some things that, you know, people need to be able to recall in a moment of, I call it risk or crisis or, you know, where you don't have the luxury of looking it up, for example. And that's part of our job too as instructional designers, is to sort through that. And it also kind of brings us back to, you know, some of the things we've talked about in other episodes too, the whole idea of do people need to know everything, or does your training focus on the things that people need to do and therefore giving them the information that they need to be able to do that, but not necessarily, you know, everything and the kitchen sink in order to be proficient that they might need. So
yes, and it's interesting to kind of, you're right, to kind of take us full circle to what Kara was mentioning. It is important that we actually measure you know, the doing and what people are actually performing on their job. That's absolutely critical. But I think there are moments in time in our discussions where we sometimes forget that the learning is an important part of the doing. So I think what we're all trying to say at the end of the day is, let's just not stop measuring at the learning point. Let's continue to measure and pay attention to, you know, the doing and hit that piece. There's still more work to be done after the learning, but it's not that we should forget about measuring the learning, because I think it's really important. You know, you hit on a good point a couple slides back about, we don't really know what the, you know, retrieval, you know, intervals should be, but with today's data, with like XAPI and all the different ways that you can collect data and information, my guess is in, you know, 10 years or so, with people being able to test different spacing repetition models, we're going to start to get a lot of data back, and it's going to start to narrow it down a little bit to say, you know what, if you space it out this many days or this many hours, or first this many hours, then this many days, then this many weeks, you get a much more solid, you know, return. Or, hey, you know what, you could probably cut out this one, this one, this one, and this one, because it's just not necessary. People are learning just fine with only this many up until this point, right? So once we start getting that data, then we can start making those smart decisions.
Dr. Talheimer's being, well, most recent addition, closing in on 10 years, there has been so much data change that that maybe there have been more opportunities to refine that sense of the spacing intervals and that kind of a thing. Yeah, I mean, you think about probably even the, you know, other tools that we're using, Facebook and Twitter and those sorts of things, they're probably already doing things to us in those tools that leverage aspects of this and are probably, you know, pretty advanced in a lot of cases, and maybe in measuring those algorithms or whatever, if it's advantageous to them from a profitability point. Yeah. So
one point I want to bring up before we or do you have more slides?
No, that's the end of it, because the next slide is a blank one.
Okay. So. I do just want to bring up, just as sort of a fun thing for everyone to think about when you, you know, as a takeaway, if you're into music, you can think about this from that perspective, especially playing music of some sort. If you've ever had the, you know, the desire to play, or if you remember playing as a kid, that is a great, I think, a great mechanism to think about repetition, spaced repetition, the forgetting curve, and all of that. Think about how many times you took piano lessons as a kid and then decided you hated it, and you were pretty good at a certain point, but now as an adult, you're like, it's been so long, you can't remember any of it, right? And so, you know, if you can look back to some of the things that you did as a child that you can't remember today, it's a great way to kind of go back and remember and to at least be able to match what we're talking about today with what Ebbinghaus found out with some of your own prior knowledge and experience. And it's also fresh on my memory right now, on my mind right now, because I'm listening to a book called Musicophilia, which is the brain researcher that wrote the book, The Man Who Mistook His Wife for a Hat. Have you ever heard of that book?
Okay, right. I know that
yeah,
title.
Yeah, anyway. It's a really popular book for like psychology 101 students to be reading when you go through college, right? So the same author wrote this about music, and he actually approaches it from a brain and a neuroscience perspective, and mostly from a deficit, a neurodeficit perspective, and that there are certain people out there that any type of music drives them crazy. Like they can't make any sense of it. It's like listening to Fingers on the Chalkboard, all types of, and it, okay. You know, just things like that. It's really interesting. So those of you that want to, you know, sort of take this to the next level, it's a great book to check out. And it's an interesting way to think about this idea of spaced repetition and the forgetting curve.
Yeah. As you started talking about music, I've been doing it myself. And when I'm noodling in the evenings and you come up with a kind of a funky riff, I've actually been making it an intention to somehow capture that so that I can go back a few days later and play that little riff again or whatever, because you know, otherwise you're sort of thinking, going, well, that was really, I remember being really happy with that little chord progression that I came up with, but you know, but what was it? And kind of in a sense, I'm, you know, some of those things programming my brain to remember them, you know, for later on. And that's, I mean, that's really what practice, musical practice in that sense is. And it also points to the fact that it's not just, you know, brain memory, it's muscle memory too. You know, it applies to lots of things. You know, that saying, it's just like riding a bicycle. Well, unless you get back on the bicycle, there's no need to remember how to ride a bicycle, because that's not something you can do in the abstract, right? I remember how to pedal. Well, unless you're actually pedaling, well, what's the need to have remembered it?
So, yeah, it's that context. I think the point that we're making to connect the two is the context. If you are in, let's say you're in a warehouse and you're learning a particular new process or a new piece of software to do the work that you do in a warehouse, I think it wouldn't be too much of a stretch to be able to say that when that learner is outside of the warehouse doing something else, it's very difficult for them to try to, you know, remember all of those different elements that they need to accomplish. But as soon as they get into that environment, things will start to trigger. I'm pretty certain everybody's had that experience, mm-hmm. right? Just the, you know, getting into a certain context, a physical space with music, it's picking up the guitar, hearing the notes, and then all of a sudden you start to remember certain things. Right. For work, it's the exact same way. Even just turning on your laptop and seeing Word and going, oh, that's what I was working on, or hitting a certain website and going, ah, yes, I remember that now. Right. So I think that context is a really important part of this. And we need to remember that also as learning professionals to embed these things in those right locations, or at least get that information to them in the right locations at the right time when they need it.
And I mean, the question that Ed had put into the chat, you know, would quizzes be good for this? As long as, in that case, if quizzes are simply abstract and about rote memory, but can you frame your quizzes, for instance, so that they reflect a more real world context? In other words, I mean, we always want the things that we're creating to help people learn from to reflect the real world context, you know, as much as possible. So maybe a quiz that's more of a decision based thing rather than simply a rote memory, you know, start thinking about that as a way to take better advantage of this kind of a thing. So, yeah. Well, not surprisingly, we've gone over time. I don't know what it is with us and time. Time
we're
has no
chatty bunch
for us. Yeah, we are. Cool. Well, yeah, that was the stuff that I brought forward today to, you know, summarizing that. If people need another place to go, definitely check out Dr. Thalheimer's website and look at the and download the PDF and see what else you can glean from that. So
absolutely. And I don't know if you can hear that, but there's the music.
There's the music.
That's it for us today, folks. I hope you enjoyed learning about a little bit of spaced repetition, and I hope you all enjoyed your cup of coffee today.
Yeah. See you next time, gang.
Ciao.